position.
Is that how it starts?
Yeah, it starts light like that.
And we're here with this Chaman Q, and this time it's mailbag time again. So, yeah, actually, this is our first mailbag, and we're going to look at the questions that you have asked us on each of our shows.
Okay, this is the answers to your questions. Here they go.
All right, the first question is from Francis Peabody, who asks you, would it be fair to say that the sole purpose for making Toltec art is to move the assemblage point of the viewer? That's the normal reason of making art, or engage the senses is irrelevant for Toltecs. That, the normal reason of making art, to please or engage the senses, is irrelevant to Toltecs.
That's a beautiful question, Francis. Of course, the main intention of the original Toltecs and their pyramid work and their underground city, their statuary, the murals, was that religious experience. I use the term religious very broadly, that spiritual mystic experience when they saw the art, that their assemblage point would be moved. As art developed in contemporary times, it became part of commerce. That was not the Tolteca original intention, and it still is not to this day. If you're part of the Tolteca lineage, you want to see your works exhibited in a temple, in a pyramid, in some sacred venue, and you continue your process in regard to having people have an assemblage point shift. If you're not doing that and you're just becoming one of the decorative arts, that would be on the wall who decided momentarily, as I myself one time, how was I going to make money in the tonneau? Well, I became a sign maker. And I pleased everybody. I developed graphics and things that, for them, were in the world. When they saw my signs, they said, wow, that's a magnificent work of art. To them, in the regular world, that would have been a fine sculpted piece out of redwood or some sort of piece of art. But as the shaman part of me was standing there, I was always saying, I want to take you away from your known with this signage. And in that regard, if you look on the backside of it, I have put a whole series of hieroglyphics that you will never be able to decipher from your office window. I made that part up, PQ.
I kind of thought you might be gilding the lily a little.
All right, what's the next question?
I was waiting for the next
question. I'm sorry. Okay, please.
The next question here, let's see, comes from All Orange. You said stalking, dreaming, and intent manifested in visual art. This is what creates impact for a long time. I can understand how stalking and dreaming are used in the process of creation, but can you explain how intent manifests in your art?
We covered that a little bit in number 5 in the show where we had me drawing, and part of intent is a recapitulation as you're sculpting or drawing of your life in the tonneau. So you will be reviewing and therefore releasing the energy through the lines and the memories. The ones you want to maintain, you're drawing the images of those so that they are frozen in the wheel of time. That is your intent. With every mark, with every brushstroke, you are intending. That's why robots do not do Tolteca art. Other people do not do Tolteca art. The artist must be transferring their intent through their physical eyes, physical hands. That is the intent of a Toltec artist.
Byro Jaffa asks, or actually says and then asks, I think he is saying that if you are not a born visual artist, painting, sculpting, architecture, you are not born part of the Toltec lineage. Sounds kind of rigid and narrow-minded. And what does history show? Castaneda was a sculptor in an earlier part of his life, but what about all the other characters in Don Juan's party and DJ Don Juan himself?
Well, of course, the first part of your question there, Bio, of course, made me really, really angry, and I wanted to respond angrily saying, I know everything and nobody else can do any art except who I say as an artist. Well, I actually believe that, because my Toltec lineage does not have room for volunteers. A benefactor sees the artist in you and acknowledges that. So, like many professions, this is not a smorgasbord of come one, come all. Yes, you are born and conceived as a Toltec artist. That's the way it is. It's not a very big club, unfortunately. It has no temples or churches that people
can come. It doesn't have a huge cachet either that everybody wants to be one.
Absolutely not. And you know, the struggle in order to maintain...
How dare you say you're one.
Yeah, exactly. I was going to get a little bit angry with you, but I love you because it's a perfect question, and a lot of people should know that, yes, it is a very disciplined and exclusive little club here, and that all the artists of Don Juan's core of sorcerers and, you know, the old sorcerers that he lists in the Castaneda books, for example, on the wall, Elias was always inventing things that he would get in his dreaming. They were sculptures. They were in a particular part of the house, and nobody really knew what they were for when he left. So I've always wondered, you know, what happened to all those amazing things from the second attention that he brought back and developed into sculptures? Were the other people involved in various other arts? I've listed before that the main arts of painting, sculpting, pyramid, those are considered the high arts, particularly of the Nawal. So let's separate that. When Carlos said, I've only met Nawals who are plastic artists, he meant to say that the other people can have the lesser arts, which are healing, curing, and even dancing. But as I've talked about before, the Nawal is responsible for leaving offerings that can exist without his presence. And that even includes a book like Carlos Castaneda did. If you are a healer, you go, all of your hands-on goes. If you're a dancer, you may leave behind a video, but the impact of your dancing goes. If you're a curer, that impact goes. You've passed it on to an apprentice, but it's always going to be distorted a little bit. The Nawal has no other choice but to work in the plastic arts. So you have Nawals in the Castaneda books who are mask makers. And another side, Carlos Castaneda had a large collection of Yaqui masks that were recently on view at the Los Angeles, at UCLA. And he was a collector of art, too, physical manifestations that the Nawals created in his interactions with them. So, yes, there can be other lesser arts, but the Nawal is a maker of intent with the eyes and the ears that has a physical manifestation that lasts for infinity, including when they are gone.
And Shana Khan
asks, Shana,
what is your take on modern art? Is that really art?
Shana, an excellent question. I hope you're going to see in this program, because I keep track as somebody who has to collect all the information in all the fields of the earth, the sciences as well as the arts. So I'm very familiar with contemporary artists. In many cases, I can say that someone like Amsel Kiefer, a modern contemporary successful artist, is bridging on the mystic. He's bringing in texts like the Kabbalah, and he's doing things that have an intention of a mystic artist. Most artists have taken that out and tried to put it in. Jeff Koons is a perfect example. He's doing plastic balloon dogs out of aluminum and giving a spiel about them being mystical manifestations of whatever. I think that is not really his intention. Now, as an artist progresses, someone like Damien Hirst, another contemporary artist, just did a show of these lost relics that were supposedly found by a sunken boat, and they're huge, encrusted with gems, and he's got the models of the boats and everything like that. So he's making like dioramas and an amusement park, along with Olaf Ellison also makes experiences where people can go in, and he bridges on the mystic. These artists, when they get to the top of their game, like Damien Hirst, have to confront the big issues that a shaman does. Life and death is a big theme with Damien Hirst, with the floating shark. If you hear them talk, they eventually want to move to the next level of artist, out of being contemporary artists and being mystic artists. And those are the ones I keep track of, because they are working to gain higher awareness through their art and give it to the people with huge, big themes. Those artists are definitely worthwhile, and they are contemporary artists. However, If you ask me what happens when I go to a museum, I am drawn usually, because those artists are rare, to the antiquarian sections that has the old relics from old civilizations, particularly obviously Tolteca. But those products carry more weight for me and more intention than any contemporary art. And that's obvious. I can read them, I can understand their dreaming and stalking intention. So that's usually where you'll find me. And I think that the artifacts that were just found under the Quetzalcoatl Pyramid are the most contemporary, amazing artifacts to see the light of day after being thousands of years in the corridor underneath the pyramid. And you put them in the museums, they're on tour now at the LA Museum, they are contemporary now. First time they're seen, they're displayed outside of the temple, they've been released, and they can still move the assemblage point, and those are the best contemporary art being exhibited today.
And remember, right there in the comments, you put your questions, and soon enough, we'll be back with answers directly from the Nawal.
Thank you all.